Hello, I'm Professor Melko, chemistry PhD, and today we're going to talk about chemical formulas and physical and chemical changes. Let's jump into the lecture. We're going to start with the law of definite composition. Okay, really defines what a compound is. A compound always contains the same elements in a constant proportion by mass. Okay, so water, for example, is a compound, and it always contains the same ratio of hydrogen to oxygen. Okay, the law of definite composition says that this composition by mass is always the same for any molecule of water, right? So stoichiometrically, we write the ratio as H2O, but by mass, this is always going to be 11.1% hydrogen. Every molecule of water, 11.1% hydrogen by mass, 88.8% oxygen by mass. Okay, this H2O that I wrote here was a chemical formula. That's the expression of the number of atoms. Right? So even though there's twice as many hydrogen atoms, it's actually by mass much more oxygen because the oxygen atom is very, very massive compared to the hydrogen atom. Okay, so this is a chemical formula. We see another one down here, H2SO4. This tells us that there's two hydrogens, one sulfur atom, if I can write, there we go, sort of, and four oxygen atoms. Okay, so this is the shorthand we use. We use the element symbols that we learned about in the past video. H for hydrogen, S for sulfur, O for oxygen, and the numbers dictate how many of those atoms there are. Sometimes chemical formulas aren't enough. You want to visualize something like a structure. Okay, so the chemical formula, of course, as we just went over, defines what element and how many of those atoms there are. Right, and we write these as subscripts, right, just below. So the hydrogen, there's two of them. Oxygen, there's one of them. That's the chemical formula for water. Since oxygen is only one atom, we don't write the one. Okay, so if you don't see a number, it's implied that it's one. Let's look at vitamin B3, a more complicated molecule. If I tell you that vitamin B3 is a molecule with six carbon atoms, you write the symbol carbon followed by the number 6 as a subscript. Five hydrogen atoms, the symbol for hydrogen is H. There's five of them. One nitrogen atom, the symbol for nitrogen, capital N. There's one of them. The one is implied. I don't write the number one. And two oxygen atoms, the formula or the symbol for oxygen is O. And there's two of them. So C6, H5, NO2. That is the chemical formula for B3. That doesn't really tell you how the atoms are organized, so a lot of times you'll see these structural formulas, and each of these sort of corners of the ring here are carbon atoms. And there's also some hydrogen atoms attached that are not drawn. And these are sort of chemists' shorthands for expressing this structural formula, right? But you can count up and see that there are six carbons, five hydrogens, two oxygens, and one nitrogen. And a lot of times you'll write the structure because multiple types of compounds might have the same number of atoms. So it turns out here that vitamin B3, right, which we just said was C6, H5, NO2, that same chemical formula applies to nitrobenzene. Six carbons, five hydrogens, one nitrogen, two oxygens. So we need the structural formula to tell us how these atoms are arranged. You can see clearly structurally, these are arranged different. Here, the N is part of the ring. Here, it's off to the side of this ring. Okay, so the formula alone may not be enough to specify the particular compound. Sometimes, instead of drawing the structure, you'll try to denote this in the chemical formula itself. Okay, so ethylene glycol tells you that these O's and H's are grouped together, right? So if I have an O, the H is going to be attached. If I have an O, the H is going to be attached. That's what this parenthesis is telling us, right? That the hydrogen and the oxygens live together, and there's two of those groups, one here and one here, okay? So look for these parentheses, and keep in mind that this two subscript, I should make a note, this two subscript outside applies to both of these atoms. Right, so that if I'm counting up the exact number of hydrogens, there's four hydrogens plus two hydrogens. So there's two carbons here, six hydrogens, and two oxygens, right? That would be another way to write this, but it's less informative because I'm not telling you here that the O's and H's are grouped together. So that's how we write these chemical formulas. We're also going to talk about in this lecture physical and chemical properties and physical and chemical changes. Right? So there's a difference between separating something physically and chemically, or a property that is physical versus chemical, right? Or a change that is physical versus chemical. Okay. Physical is something that you can observe without changing the composition, right? This elemental composition of the substance. So color, mass, density, these are physical changes, right? You can, you know, break off or shave off a little bit of copper from a copper rod, right? And change the mass of your rod of copper. Okay, that is a physical change. You are not doing anything to the elements. It's still all copper. Chemical properties, though, describe how a substance changes during reactions with other substances. Okay, so physical, you're not changing the composition. Chemical, you are, right? So trying to remember what a chemical property might be, a lot of times you'll see flammability or reactivity, and those will be keywords. Something on fire or flammability is always a chemical reaction. So burning is a chemical reaction. So if you see the words burn, flammable, reaction, those signify chemical properties and chemical change, okay? Most other things are going to be physical properties or physical change. Okay, so let's dig into that a little bit more. Physical change does not alter the chemical composition, right? Just like a physical property is observed without changing the composition. A chemical property involves a change in composition. A chemical change changes the chemical composition, right? So these are quite synonymous, physical property, physical change, with chemical property and chemical change, right? So some examples of chemical changes is gas being released, light emitted or heat released, and a permanent color change, right? So these are sort of what signify that chemistry is happening, okay? What can be confusing is something can look like it's changing in front of you and it just be a physical change, okay? So phase changes, this is one people often get wrong, but a phase change is just a physical change. It's just a change of the state. Right, an ice cube melting, you're not doing anything to the hydrogen and oxygen to turn it into a different compound. It is still just H2O. So that's just a physical change. Water, ice is becoming liquid water. Just a physical change. It's still water, right? Chemical change might be now you're putting something, submerging it in water, and you're seeing this vigorous bubbling of gas. Okay, that's a detail that tells us there's some kind of chemistry happening. Something that's changing and the compounds, moving around the atoms and making new compounds. Light emitted or heat release. Okay, so if you pour two liquids together and it gets really, really hot, all of a sudden that releasing of heat is telling you some chemistry is happening and some energy is being released as a breaking and forming of bonds are occurring. Also a permanent color change, right? So this can also signify some chemical change, some chemistry is happening, again, some rearrangement of atoms into a different compound. Okay, let's try a quiz. Read through this, try to classify each of these as a physical or chemical change. Feel free to pause the video now and try it yourself. Liquid mercury. Mercury is capital H, lowercase g. Okay. Cools to a solid, right? So this mercury is not turning into a different compound. It's still mercury. It's just going from a liquid phase to a solid phase. So this is just a phase change. This is just a physical change. The second one, propane grill burns with a blue and orange flame. Okay. Anything that's burning, on fire, flammable, that's chemistry happening. That's a chemical change. Right? This heat released that happens during this burning is evidence of this chemical change. The last one, ammonia mixed with copper turns permanently blue. Remember, a permanent color change here is a chemical change, right? Something that's irreversible. You have altered the very essence of this substance, and that's evidenced by this permanent color change. The last concept in this lecture we're going to cover is the conservation of mass and energy laws. So you can have the law of conservation of mass, and you can have the law of conservation of energy. They're both pretty synonymous. One is just for mass, one is for energy, right? Basically, mass is never created nor destroyed. Energy is never created nor destroyed, right? So in terms of chemistry, if you have A turning into B, mass must be conserved, okay? The mass of substance A equals the mass of substance B, right? If all of A is turning into all of B, if it starts at 5 grams, you have 5 grams of product it's turning into. You're never creating or destroying matter, right? So example of this, 1 gram of hydrogen plus 8 grams of oxygen. And if you're having this chemical reaction of hydrogen plus oxygen, let me just balance it real quick, is turning into water. If you have 1 gram of oxygen and 8 grams of water, 1 gram of hydrogen, 8 grams of oxygen, and that's turning into all water, you have 9 grams of water, right? The left side mass equals the right side mass. So that's the law of conservation of mass. Synonymously, the law of conservation of energy is that energy is never created nor destroyed. Now you can manipulate energy, turn energy into different forms of energy, right? So you can take heat energy and turn it into mechanical energy, right? Or solar energy and turn it into electrical energy. That's what solar panels do. But you're never destroying energy, okay? So overall, those are the laws of conservation of mass and energy. And that'll wrap up this lecture where we talked about physical and chemical changes, writing chemical formulas, and these laws of conservation of mass. So that'll do it. You can, as always, subscribe to the YouTube channel for more videos like this, or check me on Twitch every week where I do office hours and science news.